الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. Welcome to our next episode in our series on the life of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And we had reached the first few years of the da'wah when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went public, and when the Hajj came, the Quraysh, they tried to do whatever they could to stop the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now the Hajj was over, and now the Quraysh had to deal with this problem, and they started to come up with different strategies to deal with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They saw Islam as a new religion and not as a reformation of the religion that was already there, which was the true teachings of Ibrahim alayhi salam. They said that this is a new religion that this person is trying to spread. They used techniques like ridicule, abuse, slander, debate, and open harassment of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his followers. They said that the shaitan teaches him. He's learning from shaitan and then coming out. Also, they said that they would see the Sahaba in a group and they would say, look at the rulers of the earth. And they would basically laugh at them and say, look, these are the rulers of the earth. They would hurl profane remarks about the Quran, about Allah and his Prophet. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَلَا تَجْهَرْ بِصَلَاتِكَ وَلَا تُخَافِدْ بِهَا وَابْتَغِي بَيْنَ ذَلِكَ سَبِيلًا. Don't recite too loud, nor completely silently, rather follow a middle course. So of course these people, when they would hear the Quran, they would say stuff about the Quran. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that don't be so loud where you're you know, proactively trying to reach them so that they could insult you. But don't do it completely silently. Don't stop what you are doing, but rather take a low tone. And this is actually something that we find in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that when someone prayed with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if they were close enough to him, they could understand every word that he was saying. So actually, the most correct way of praying, the most correct Sunnah, is to actually read in a voice, which is, if someone stood right next to you, they could hear and understand what is it that you are saying. It should not be completely silent, as many people do. The Quraysh also came up with a new strategy, and they hired a man from among them whose name was Nadir bin Harith. And this man was a storyteller. In fact, he traveled to Hira and Syria to learn the stories of kings and commanders of the past, Darius, Alexander, Isfandiar, and he basically learned these stories simply so that he could rival the Quran. Whenever he heard the Prophet ﷺ was addressing an assembly, he would rush there and start telling his stories. And he would say to the people that, how can the stories of Muhammad be better than stories that I am telling you? In fact, he went to the next level and he purchased some girls, slave girls, who were good at singing. And if he saw a person listening to the Prophet ﷺ, he would individually go and pick them off. And he would say, come here, I have something for you. And he would take him from in front of the Prophet ﷺ, and he would tell the girls, go and entertain him. So they would serve him food and drink, and they would sing for him so that he would basically not listen to the Prophet ﷺ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed an ayah that the Mufassireen say is about this man Nadir bin Harith, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَشْرِي لَهُ الْحَدِيثِ لِيُضِلَّ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. That, and of the people is he who buys the amusement of speech to mislead others from the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ, without any knowledge, and he takes it in ridicule, he makes fun of the Quran. Those will have a humiliating punishment. They will have a humiliating punishment. The Quraysh also started other forms of propaganda against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Among the things that they said was that the Prophet sees some type of confused and convoluted dreams, and then he comes and he tells the people about them, that this is his new religion. They also said that the Quran is his own speech. He's making it up himself. They also said that there is someone else who's teaching him. We don't know who this person is, but someone else is teaching him, and then he's coming out and he's saying that this is the Quran, this is not the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They also said that the Quran was all lies. This is all lies, or these are all ancient stories, folk tales. Also, they said that this is a Quran revealed by the shaitan. This is Quran is revealed by the shaitan, and the Prophet is not, Muhammad is not receiving an angel from Allah, rather he is receiving a shaitan who is inspiring him. Also, they said that the Prophet suffered from fits and seizures, that he was mentally sick. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and among them is that he's a poet, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran that the poets are not like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Their followers are often, you know, if you look at people who are like really deeply into poetry, they're often like messy people. You know, a lot of times, you know, they say like messy hair. You think of a deep poet and you imagine him to be someone with a messy appearance, someone who's kind of lost in thought. And a lot of times they will expound on subjects that without any discretion. So they will go deep and deep and deep into a subject. And a lot of times it's profane, vulgar, like, you know, basically splitting hairs. And they boast about deeds that they did not perform. This is what Allah says poets are. Now, subhanAllah, this propaganda machine that was unleashed against the Prophet ﷺ is not very different than the propaganda machine that is unleashed against Muslims today. So we are not living in a new situation. Some TV channels, news stations, which are always targeting Islam. This is not something new. In fact, this is something which is as old as prophethood itself. Allah says in the Quran that not a single prophet came before the Prophet except that people made fun of them. People mocked them. People called them liars. People said bad words about them. And this hurt the Prophet ﷺ just as it hurts us when people talk bad about Islam. However, the key to follow, the key to understand is to follow what the Prophet ﷺ did, is that to stay firm on the path and to continue giving da'wah, to continue to look for those precious pearls among the around in the society and guide them to Islam by the tawfiq of Allah, and then let them go and then multiply that effect. And slowly but surely, 13 years, the Prophet ﷺ has only 130 people that believe in him. But then the next 10 years, now those 130 people, when they're unleashed in Medina, they're not under the persecution of the Meccans. In 10 years, the Prophet ﷺ takes the 130 people to literally 140,000 people that actually made Hajj with him 10 years later in the same place where the Prophet ﷺ was being persecuted in just 10 years. And of course, these 140,000 that were actually there to make Hajj with him, all of the people, these were not all the Muslims. There were lots of people that were left back in their cities, and some Hujjaj came. And just a few of those were the 140,000 that had come for Hajj that year.
Another strategy that the Quraysh tried to stop Islam, which was to bring forth arguments and quibbling about issues that were being presented by Islam. There were three main issues that the Quraysh could not digest. These were three things that they had a problem with. Number one was resurrection, the idea that we will be raised up alive again. Number two was the idea of a mortal prophet, a man from among them who is now chosen by Allah and receiving a revelation, and they are now supposed to follow him and his example. And number three is the idea of one God, the idea of one God who is the only one that is deserving of worship. So some of the things that they said with regards to resurrection is that they said that after we become dust, how is it that we're going to come back alive? And they would make fun of the Prophet ﷺ and the Muslims, and they would say, oh, do you want me to show you somebody who says that once we become dust and bones are, even bones will decompose? And this man, let me show you a man who says that we will come back alive after that. The Quran presented some arguments and answers to their arguments, which are something which are powerful even today for someone who wishes to explain, especially to people who doubt this idea, and even to our young Muslims who may not really understand Islam with evidences. A lot of times some parents, they will just tell the kids that, look, this is how it is. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us logical arguments that appeal to a logical mind and that makes sense. So among these arguments is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that أَفَنَجْعَلُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ كَالْمُجْرِمِينَ. Should we make the good ones the same as the bad ones? Simple as that. So basically what that means is that should we take if there was an oppressor who oppressed a lot of people, you know, think about somebody like Hitler, and then this man dies without being punished in this life for all his sins, compared to another man who spent all his life in worship of Allah, being good to people. And you know, I always give the example of Isa alayhi salam in Western gatherings, because you know, majority of the people, they tend to be Christian. And you know, I say that even if we don't accept the Isa alayhi salam as a prophet, or as Christians do, as a son of God, I think that all humanity can agree that Jesus as a man was a good, righteous person. He was not known for any crimes. He was a person who was going around teaching good manners. So everyone can agree on that. And they say, yeah, we can agree on that. So I asked them that, is it fair of God that Jesus lives all his life in the way that he lives, and Hitler lives the life that he lived, and then when they both die without being rewarded or punished in this life, that when they both die, God does not do anything to them for what they did? It would not be fair of God to leave them just lying dead in their grave. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he tells us that this is the purpose of the day of resurrection, that the people will be paid back for what they did in this life. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will then balance the affairs between the people. The oppressor who had power in this world oppressed those who did not have power. On the day of resurrection, the oppressor will be the weak one and the oppressed will be the strong one. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will basically take, punish that person on behalf of this crime that he did against this oppressed person. So, also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, can Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give life to dead? What proof do we have of that? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that if Allah created the heavens, you look at the planets, you look at the stars, you look at the moons, you look at all the astronomical bodies that exist there. If we can believe that God created them the first time, then what, you know, difficulty would he have in recreating us? And another argument Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala presented is that if Allah created us the first time, then why can he not create us the second time? So very simple and very, you know, it makes sense that, of course, if Allah can create us the first time, there should be no problem in him creating us a second time. You know, example that we use is, if a person makes a prototype of a product, that first prototype is the hardest one to make because of all the research and development that goes in there. But once you make one model, then every other model that comes after that basically copies that same one. You're just making carbon copies of them. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the human being. And not only he created the human being, he created every human being in a unique manner. No one human being is an exact copy of another human being. Even two kids who are born as twins, identical twins, even they have different personalities at times. They have differences among them that, you know, people who know them can tell that this is the difference between them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Allah did not become tired or unable to create after he created you the first time. The second issue that they had was the issue of a mortal prophet, that how can a prophet of God eat and walk among us in the markets? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they basically said that how can it be a regular man? He should have been an angel. And they said that a regular man cannot receive revelation from Allah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that, number one, that if we sent an angel in angelic form, then you would not be able to see him, because the human body is not designed to be able to interact with an angel in the angelic body. So that is out of the question. You would immediately die. Number two is that if Allah sent an angel in the form of a human being, so people could interact with him, but when they would realize that he's not a human being like us, he doesn't get hungry like us, then how can he tell us to fast for 16 hours a day when he doesn't get hungry and we get hungry? How can he tell us to not drink water when he doesn't get thirsty and we get thirsty in the month of Ramadan? How can he tell us to stay away from, you know, zina and alcohol when he doesn't have any of those temptations and he has no desire to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inside of him as nature, while we all do? So this is not a fair thing, question to ask, and this is, you know, we're not going to follow him because he's asking us to do that something that we cannot do. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, that's why we sent you a prophet from among you, and to every nation we sent them a prophet from among them, so that they would not say this. They would not say that, oh Allah, the messenger that you sent us, we could not follow him. We could not pray like him. We could not fast like him, because he did not have the same needs as the needs that we have. Also, they believed in Ibrahim alayhi salam as a prophet of God. And they believed in Ismail alayhi salam as a prophet of God. And some of them believed in Musa alayhi salam because they dealt with Jews. So they believed in Musa alayhi salam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, then how come, you know, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is just the same person in that same line, continuing the same message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Then they said that how come this man, how come Muhammad is the prophet? How come Muhammad is the prophet? There are so many better people that could have deserved to be the prophet of God. How come they are not the prophets? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala simply said, أَهُمْ يَقْسِمُونَ رَحْمَةَ رَبِّكَ. Are they distributing the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? It is Allah that distributes to whomever He likes. And you don't choose who Allah decides to make poor and who Allah decides to make rich. You don't choose who Allah decides to make a prophet and who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't decide to make a prophet. Then they said, how come Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not wealthy? How come he's not a powerful person? And why does he have to trade in the market to earn a living? How come he doesn't have a treasure that descends on him if he's an angel, if he's a prophet of God? Or how come an angel doesn't walk with him in the markets to protect him, to take care of his needs as a servant if he's really the prophet of God? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he basically responded and he said that, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the prophet to all people. If had the prophet been like a kingly person, then he would not be able to really reach the poor and the needy, because then again they would say that the king is telling us to fast and pray, and we are people that are hungry, we never have food anyways, and then he's telling us even more to stay away from food when his coffers are full and we are empty. So, you know, that argument doesn't fly as well. Thirdly, the concept of worshipping one God, the concept of worshipping one God. Now, the mushrikeen of Makkah, they accepted Allah as one. They accepted Allah, they believed in Allah as one. That He's the Creator, He's the Lord of all, He's the one that provides for all, He gives and takes life, and no one else can challenge His decisions. That much they believed in. But what they believed in, the problematic belief that they had, was that they believed in God's helpers. These righteous people, who were so righteous and so virtuous, that now they are close to God, and they can intercede on their behalf. And they themselves, the people, are too impure, they're too unholy to reach God directly. So what they do is that they send their dua, their worship, their sacrifice to these helpers, you know, kind of like the ministers of a king. And they can reach him, and if they can please the minister, then the minister will simply go and whisper in the ear of the king, and the king will give them whatever they want. So they used to visit statues, they used to rub the walls of these shrines, they used to make tawaf around them, they used to make offerings of food and gold and animals. All offerings were done through offering to attendants who would place them in front of the idol for some time. Now, of course, the idol is not going to eat. It is the attendant of that idol that you basically ends up eating and taking all that gold and stuff like that, which is something that still happens until today when people go to these shrines and they are sacrificing for Allah. It is not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that takes that. It is basically those attendants, the people who basically made it a business to make people, misguide people in the name of God. And now they are getting wealthy off of that. They're getting wealthy off of that. And some animals would be left to roam free. So they would basically buy an animal and they would say that I'm sacrificing this cow for the sake of Allah. So they would mark this cow with some type of branding and then they would just leave it to roam free and nobody would touch it. And nobody would slaughter it and nobody would harm it. They would say that this is a cow that has been endowed for God. And this is something that, you know, in India, people still do today, that they worship cow as one of the deities, and the people don't, you know, in some areas they don't slaughter the cows. And I've heard stories that, you know, people who live on the Pakistani side of the Indian border, they are very happy when cows cross over, and they basically take them over and they, you know, slaughter them and enjoy the beef and sell the beef and all of those things. Because of course we don't worship anyone besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah has created the cows and the sheep for the purpose of people eating them as, you know, protein. Another few practices that they would do is that they would sometimes carry the animal or take the animal to the house of the holy men, and they would slaughter them there in the name of their idol that they worship. Also, they used to have a fair, like a festival once or twice a year, like Hajj for idols, and they would basically gather together and they would remember their forefathers during that time, and they used to do this in Hajj as well. And sometimes they would address the idols as, "O Father, answer my request." So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put forth some arguments. And number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that, how do you know that this person that you consider to be someone who was close to God is actually close to God? No book has come down, like the Bible doesn't mention that such and such is that person. No book has come to you, the mushrikeen of Makkah, that how can you say that, you know, this person is close to God? You know, and in Islam, we cannot say that such and such person is a shaheed. We can only say, may Allah accept him as a shaheed, except if Allah or his messenger have specifically told us that such and such person is a shaheed. Other than them telling us, we cannot even say that such and such person is a shaheed, because we don't know what intention they died on. That is only between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that you don't have knowledge of the unseen, and you don't have any book that has come to you that tells you that these people are so close to God that they can intercede on your behalf. So what is your proof? And they basically said, "Inna wajadna alayha aba'ana," that we found our forefathers doing this, and that's what we are doing. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that those that you pray to are also servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like you. They cannot hear you and they cannot answer. If they can hear you, they cannot answer your prayers. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that they don't even possess the qitmir, which is the membrane that covers the date stone. You know, when you open up a date, there's a very thin membrane on the date seed or the date stone. And this membrane is called kitmir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that they don't even have that. They don't even have that. And of course, we see this all around us, that no matter how wealthy a person is, when he goes in his grave, you know, he's at the mercy of the people that prepared his body. If they gave him a good shroud, then he has a good shroud. And even that shroud is, of course, going to be gone very soon, decomposing in the earth. Also what they did is that they came and they threatened the Prophet and the Muslims. They said that, "You guys keep saying this about our gods are going to punish you." So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responded that, "Do they have feet that they can walk on?" You know, you're saying about punishment, let's talk about something more basic. Do they have feet that they can walk on? Do they have hands that they can grab or hold something to punish it? Do they have eyes with which they can see? Do they have ears that they can hear with? Go ahead and send their wrath and don't give me a break. You know, hurry up and send me that wrath, and, you know, make sure that I don't even get a break from that wrath. Don't have mercy on me. Of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, ثُمَّ كِيدُونِي فَلَا تُنْظِرُونَ, that go, you know, tell them this, that go ahead, see if you can punish them. And they cannot, of course, those gods, they are not able to do anything. In fact, some of the Muslims, they must have, they made a comment to some mushrikeen that look at your gods, they are so useless, they are so helpless, that if a fox comes and urinates on them, they cannot even stop the fox from doing so. And this really enraged them, and they actually, they returned back and they really cursed the Muslims and the Prophet and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed an ayah for all of us to follow, which is وَلَا تَسُبُّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ, that do not curse those who are worshipped besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because if you do that, then they will then in return curse and insult Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, of course, in a respectable setting, we are welcome to debate with them, we are welcome to discuss with them, we are allowed to present proofs of the truth that we believe in, and present proofs of why they cannot be correct. However, all of that has to be done in respectful settings when both parties agree to be respectful, and the people that are there accept that this is not, you know, any type of insult match going on here. In that type of a setting, we're not even supposed to say anything. We're not supposed to speak over there about their gods, because then in return they will then insult Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed another ayah in which He commanded the Muslims that if you are in a gathering where they are saying bad things about Allah and His Messenger, then do not remain sitting there. So if you cannot stop them without doing any harm, if you cannot stop them, then you should not remain sitting in that gathering. You should leave from there until they change the topic of their speech. Now, after all of this, the verbal debates were not working to stop Islam. So then they decided on a new strategy, which we will expound upon more, which was the physical persecution of the Muslims of Mecca. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the proper understanding of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and to give us a tawfiq to learn from it lessons that we can implement in our own lives. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.